5 to 7 with a $10 kids meal. That's an 8-inch one-topping pizza, a cake pop, and soda. Then from 7 until 9, transition to adult karaoke. Recently featured as one of KC's best coffee places, visit Station7MCBC.com for more information. And come see us at the corner of 7 Highway and Colburn Road in Lee Summit.
I'm still going for it, even with higher stroke risk from atrial fibrillation and a regular heartbeat not caused by a heart valve problem. Over a three-year study, Eliquis apixaban tablets reduced stroke risk better than warfarin, and over 97% of Eliquis patients did not experience a stroke. A first stroke occurred in 2.9% of warfarin patients versus 2.3% of Eliquis patients.
Don't stop taking prescription Eliquis without asking your doctor. It may increase your stroke risk. Eliquis can cause serious and in rare cases fatal bleeding. Don't take Eliquis if you have an artificial heart valve, abnormal bleeding, or antiphospholipid syndrome. While taking, you may bruise more easily or take longer for bleeding to stop. A spinal injection while on Eliquis increases risk of blood clots, which may cause paralysis, the inability to move. Get medical help right away for unexpected bleeding, unusual bruising, or tingling, numbness, or muscle weakness. Medications such as aspirin products, NSAIDs, SSRIs, SNRIs, and blood thinners may increase bleeding risk. Tell your doctor about all planned medical or dental procedures. Learn more at Eliquis.com or call 1-855-ELIQUIS.
If your credit card bills have gotten out of hand, call Consolidated Credit now. If the interest rates on your credit cards are so high, it'll take years to get out of debt. Call Consolidated Credit now. They've helped over 10 million people. Without destroying your credit, they can reduce your interest rates, lower your total payments up to 50% to get you out of debt fast. For a free consultation, call Consolidated Credit now. The program works.
Call 800-210-4298. 800-210-4298. 800-210-4298.
Consolidated Credit Solutions Incorporated, 5701 West Sunrise Boulevard, Fort Lauderdale, Florida, 33313. Licensed by the New York Department of Financial Services and by the Vermont Department of Financial Regulation. Kansas CSO 0019051. Maryland DM 1492. Oregon DM 892. Licensed by the Virginia State Corporation Commission, license number DC83. Service may adversely affect the individual's credit. Non-payment of debt may lead to additional finance charges or collections activity, including legal action. Actual interest rates, length of program, and monthly payment reductions will vary by consumer and creditor. Yours could be higher or lower. Not a loan company. We do not lend money.
You're listening to the most powerful sports station in the country. Sports Radio 810, WHB Kansas City, the power of sports.
America's largest all-sports radio station presents the number one motorsport show for over two decades, Track Talk, brought to you by Rod In Supply and the Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprints. Here are the racing boys, Scott Traylor and Kirk Elliott.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Sports Radio 810 WHB. It's Track Talk, and it's all brought to you by Rod In Supply, featuring the Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprints. Who we got running the show back there at 810?
We got Jay Powers back
there. Jay Powers running the show back there, and Todd Surprise running the show here for us here at RBN, the Racing Boys Broadcasting Network. We got a good show lined up for you today, folks. Carter Soff, David Gravel, and then we've got somebody from out at the drag strip, don't we?
Blake Housley, who is the president of Flying H Drag Strip, grand opening this weekend. He's going to be joining us live.
Are you going to go out there a little bit?
I was out there yesterday to watch the first timed runs down the new drag strip yesterday. So
why didn't you tell me you went out there yesterday?
I tried. He did.
I told you that.
He reached out
Thursday.
To you.
And then I tried to call you. You said you wanted to go out there, and then yesterday I tried to call you, but I got no answer from Scott Traylor. So I just said, well, I'm just going to go ahead and go. So I went out there about noontime. The first cars headed down the track. I know they'd had cars going down the track before that.
How'd that?
But the official first timed runs were like at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. They had the national anthem, and there were some people in the stands, and so it was kind of cool to see the first timed runs down the new drag strip at Flying H.
There's a
Kirk,
photo.
Let me ask you a question. What was the quickest car that ran down the strip?
I would say a Pro Modified, mm-hmm. and I'm not sure who was behind the wheel. And I saw a time of 3.66 in a Pro Modified. That's kind of an unofficial time. But as I'm listening to the great PA system that they have installed out at Flying H Drag Strip. It is a good PA system, I might add.
Right.
I think I heard the time 366.
Are they going to run today?
Yes.
They are.
And
all
tomorrow.
Day today, and then tomorrow, some actual race competition, no prep drags are going on tomorrow afternoon. So a lot of cars in the pits. I saw a lot of different variety of race cars in the pits yesterday, and it's all paved pits, by the way. And a large group of drag racers itching to get down this drag strip. Scott, it's been since 2011 we've had drag racing in Kansas City. That's when KCIR closed,
right.
So people were
chomping
at the bit to get out there, and it was a beautiful day yesterday. A little bit on the windy side, but
yep.
Got a great facility out there at I-70 Motorsports Park.
We're looking at a little bit of the graphics.
Did you feel like what you saw out there is you think it's going to lead up to a national event next year, Kurt?
I do believe that.
Did you talk to anybody out there?
I spoke with Blake Housley, who I say we're going to have on here a little bit later on in the hour. I asked him, one of the first questions I asked him when I was lining up the bit for him to come on was, what about a national event? He said 2025. They thought maybe they might be able to get it this year, but they, you know, a new racetrack, they want to go through a full season, just make sure they work out all the bugs,
right.
And look towards 2025 with the NHRA national event. So my only suggestion is, if you get it on the 2025 calendar, please don't schedule it up against the Knoxville Nationals in August. That's my only request.
Yeah.
Do you remember the last 3 years at Heartland Park, they had it up against the Knoxville Nationals?
Don't do that.
Don't do that. Anyway, there's going to be, if you look at the schedule for this year, in September, they've got a big Pro Mod event out there. And I love Pro. I know you do too, Scott.
I love them.
And that's just one of the big events. They got a lot of bracket racing going on out there.
Is that a no prep race?
Tomorrow they're going to run a no prep race. Tomorrow's the no prep race.
Right.
But from what I saw out there, just walking around yesterday, it's a beautiful facility. Of course, you and I have been out there driving around up, you know, a couple
being nosy.
Weeks ago, you and I drove in there,
right.
Took a look at the place, but to see it with race cars in the pits and cars going down the racetrack.
Where did they pit the cars at, Kurt?
The paved pit area that
there's a photo right there.
The other day on the back side of the grandstand of the dirt track.
Right there.
Boy, they laid down a lot of rubber, didn't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not concrete no more.
It is an all concrete racetrack.
It just don't look like it no more. These photos are from John Lee from High Flying Photos. We appreciate John posting those last night, and I grabbed these because I found out we were having this guest on today. So appreciate John Lee. And
John had his drone out there.
That's where this photo's from. Yeah, good photo with John with his drone. So we appreciate that, letting him use that this morning.
But they still have work to do on the scoring tower. They need to finish that up, and there's a lot of things that need to be done before they host national event next year. But it is a beautiful facility. Hats off to all of the people that made this all happen, Scott Higgs and Blake Housley and everybody who built this beautiful drag facility. I will say this, Scott, it's a step up from the old KCIR. We can say that.
Well, why wouldn't it be?
Yeah. Why wouldn't it be?
KCIR
was just wore out. I can see a lot of potential with this track. There's a lot of room, so if they need to add things, they can. From what I'm seeing, it looks really cool. Like I said, you can see the staging where they got the cars back there in the back there. How
Todd, you're
going
to have your car out there before you know
I think
it.
I got it sold. So I'm,
do you?
Yeah, I got a couple guys looking at it. So I don't know. But my biggest concern is me tearing something up and then I'd have to fix it. That's my biggest concern.
Right.
But let me tell you, they had a lot of cars. I was surprised by some of the photos I saw John post. There was a lot of cars out there, Kirk. There wasn't just a handful. There was quite a few cars.
It was a big group of racers out there itching to get down the racetrack this weekend.
I might go out there today.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot. Today's no, it's really warm day today and tomorrow, and the wind might be a little bit less than what it was.
Maybe I should go out yesterday. To the no prep deal tomorrow.
Tomorrow would be a good.
That'd be a good
that'd
one.
That'd be a good
that'd
one.
That'd be actual competition.
Actual competition.
Are we on the list, Kurt?
We'll
talk,
yeah.
Talk to your the guy here is, in just a minute.
I told him you were coming yesterday, but you never showed up. You said you were coming.
Well, you talked
when
to the,
I talked to you on Thursday. So
we'll talk to the VP
here a
little bit. I couldn't
get a hold
of
you yesterday, my friend. I don't know where you were.
He was working on his grill.
Hey, I had to take care
you
of my
had things to do.
I
get it.
The most important thing I had to do is take care of my grandson yesterday.
Oh, you had? Yeah, that's important.
I have
that's
to,
important.
Every day this week, I've been driving my grandson from Grandma's out to Overland Park to where Blue Pearl's at, 110th and Neiman Road. That's where I go.
Now, when's the first race your grandson's going to attend? Where's that going to be?
I'm not sure where that's going to be.
It won't be long, though, right?
It won't be too long. Maybe down at the Tulsa Shootout.
Well, that's a long ways away. That's like December.
But he's not old enough to really comprehend everything that's going on
you
around
want
him.
Yeah,
right
he, understand.
Yeah,
what's
I want
happening.
Him to understand what's he, going
you
on.
You don't want to scare him. You don't want to freak
don't
him out.
You don't want to
scare
him. Because
that's what'll right. unless you're living it like every day.
Hey, listen.
So I get
the,
it.
The greatest thing that's ever happened to me in my lifetime, besides my two kids that I've had, is the blessing of my grandson. I'm telling you, it is the most satisfying thing ever. Todd, wait till you have a grandson, bud. Just so you know. You're going to have one sooner or later.
Don't push that cart too fast, man. I'm just, I got to get this.
You're not ready for that?
I've got a kid just getting out of high school, and I got a daughter who just got married, and she's just got a new job. So she's not looking anytime soon right now. So.
She's not looking to get
pregnant. She just got a promotion and a new position at her company that she's working at. And so I asked her. They're not anytime soon. So it'll be a while. But
right.
I completely understand where you're coming from. Let
me tell you something, Todd. Just so you know, that is the biggest joy of my life is having my grandson, to be honest with you.
Oh, I can't imagine.
Yep. It is awesome. Yep. Hey, I-70 is going to be a big center of activity here in the Kansas City area over the next couple of weeks. The drag strip this weekend gets center stage.
Power I next
drag
week.
Strip. Next week, we're going to be out there for the dirt track event, the Rod End Supply Open Wheel Classic. You're going to be out there working the event out there.
I'm going to be the pit reporter.
How about that?
Yeah.
And so we're going to see 410 wing sprint cars. We're going to see non-wing NWRA sprints and 305 sprints out there next Saturday night. So looking forward to that. As, you know, it's here, I-70. You know, that place sat idle from 2008 up until a couple of years
2007,
ago.
2007, I think it was.
It's back.
It is.
In all its glory out there. But, you know, I was looking at, you know.
They've spent millions and millions and millions of dollars out
they
there.
They did. But it appears that the drag strip, now that it's open, is going to get a lot more activity than the dirt track.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're going to see, if you look at the schedule, there's events scheduled just pretty much every week throughout the summer out there. Special events at the dirt track, and there's a high limit event, two night event that's coming
you
up.
Remember
the
this video?
Classic
look at
I-70.
That, look at that place.
Remember this
before they? Yep. That's before they went to work on I-70 out there. The dilapidated old I-70 Speedway that sat.
This is 2016.
Ripping away for years, and that's what it looked like.
You know, to me, that is shocking to see that.
Yeah, remember when we played this, I remember Scott saying, I can't believe what I'm looking at. And then to see what we're looking at now.
I raced there so many years, it's just hard to believe that the condition that racetrack was in.
All I got to say is I'm glad that they've Redid it. Regardless of what was going to be put there or not, I'm just so glad that
they brought it back.
They brought it back, and then it wasn't just another lost racetrack, like you said. I mean, I didn't go there very often. I mean, I think I went two races in my life there, but to have something just sitting there like that, it was just kind of a sad reminder.
You know me personally, I think that they could have saved a lot of money by just putting dirt on the old racetrack.
From what I'm understanding, there was a lot of issues, I think, from with the old gas. What was the things that were under the I know they had some issues with, I don't know what it was, the inside here, when they talked about it, they said that they had to dig up a bunch of stuff. I'm afraid that if they would have covered it up, you might have just had an issue with, like you kind of have at Lakeside sometimes, where you get the problem when the floods and you get the water kind of seeping, sticking up on.
It's pretty sad to see it in that condition.
Yeah, no, like you said, I'm glad that somebody stepped up and did the right thing, because this is a guy who just snuck in on his motorcycle, guys, and took this video, and we would have never saw this video if this guy wouldn't have just snuck in. I mean, this is an amazing looking 2016 to where we stand today. Great progress out there.
Right, no doubt.
Yeah, I didn't like that dirt track when they had it on top of the pavement the first time. So I don't agree with you that that's what they should have done, but I think you and I both agree that they made I-70 maybe a little bit too big.
Well,
shortened up the configuration a bit.
This is the problem with it, Kirk. If they're going to make it too big, just put the dirt on the old racetrack, because it's too big anyway, right? That track was a 5.66 half mile. It was a big half mile.
And it's even a bigger half mile now.
I don't think it's as big. I don't think it's
You don't think
big.
This track is as big as the old paint track?
I don't think it is.
Okay. Yeah, I can't tell you, but from looking from this photo, it's a really wide track, man. I'm amazed at how big those turns
man,
are,
that,
actually.
That is the ultimate facility. You got a drag strip.
I mean, that's cool,
You got
man.
A dirt track right behind it. I think it's going to be a fantastic facility for many years to come.
Yeah,
I'm impressed with the construction of the actual drag strip. It is a world-class drag strip, all concrete, and they spared nothing with this drag strip when the drainage, the infrastructure of the track itself, they had people who knew what they were doing to put this drag strip together, and it's built to last, and it's going to be a world-class, it already is, world-class facility out at Odessa, Missouri.
Hey, Kirk, last night David Gravel picked up the win over Buddy Kofoid and Carson Macedo. But I think maybe the story of the night is Bill Balog, how well he was running. Did you see how
he's
well?
He's been running well. That's been not running the first really time good. He's run well. Yeah. And Bill Balog has won a lot of races. A lot of people think Bill Balog's a guy that comes out of, they call him the North Pole Nightmare.
Right.
That he's not, a lot of people don't know about Bill Balog, but he's won a lot of races and championships up in Wisconsin and up in the northern part of this country, and he's a good race car driver.
I think the only chance that Buddy Kofoid had to win that race is when they got into traffic.
Yeah.
To be honest with you, because I don't think Buddy Kofoid was near as fast as David Gravel. Would you agree with that, Kurt?
Yeah, I would agree. And Gravel, he worked the low side of the racetrack, and if anybody was ever going to get around him, they were going to have to do it on the outside.
Right.
And, we saw Buddy go to the high side, but it wasn't working as well as what Gravel had going on at the bottom of the racetrack.
But, David Gravel in 1 and 2 would rip the top. And then on the bottom in 3 and 4, that's where he ran is the bottom in 3 and 4.
Yeah, the corners were different. 3 and 4 was different than 1 and 2.
They were.
So Gravel now with 2 wins and a second place finish in his last 3 starts. Do you think that we can officially name him as the favorite to win the World of Outlaw Championship this year?
I'm not going out there quite yet on the limb.
Too early, isn't it?
Too early.
Yeah. A lot of races yet to go. Tonight they're going to be wrapping up the weekend out at Federated I-55 Speedway. The High Limit Series was supposed to get back into action last night, but floods and rain put the stop to that at Texarkana 67 Speedway last night, so that event was canceled. They'll now look forward to the Texas Motor Speedway dirt track tonight, tomorrow night, RPM Speedway, and it's been a while since we've seen the high limit guys out on the racetrack, so tonight is the night down at Texas Motor Speedway dirt track.
David Gravel has a 56-point lead over Donnie Schatz, 68-point lead over Giovanni Selzy, and 82-point lead over Logan Schuchart. Who do you think? Who do you think's the favorite to win this race?
I think David Gravel is. I think he's been the most consistent so far. Some of these other guys have been up and down. I'm seeing the performance out of Carson Macedo that we've been waiting on all year long. He is slowly but surely, they've got a couple of new crew members on the Jason Johnson Racing team, and they're slowly but surely becoming more consistent. But David Gravel, to me, has the best infrastructure in place to pull this off. He was the second place runner last year to Brad Sweet, so I'd have to say David Gravel right now would be the heavy favorite.
Carson Macedo is currently fifth in the points. He's 104 points out.
Yeah, and Gio Selzy, who had been up in a tie for the lead just a couple of weeks ago, he had a pretty good car last night. He started up front, but he ended up in fifth place. He got passed by a couple of guys there at the end. Buddy Kofoid looked pretty strong last night, one of his stronger efforts of the year. Right now you'd have to say David Gravel would be the favorite based on what we've seen so far.
And we've got a little soundbite from Mostly Motorsports when David Gravel was on with us on Monday, don't we?
We do that, and we'll hear from David Gravel here in just a little bit from that interview that we had on Monday's Mostly Motorsports show. So we've got that coming up. Carter Sarf, as you mentioned a little bit earlier, won the midget race up at US 36 a week ago on Friday. He was in the Extreme Outlaw Midget Series in Sweet Springs, and last night at Farmer City.
Carter Sarf is going to be a talented driver.
I think so. He had kind of a rough go of it last night at Farmer City, where Ryan Timms picked up the win. But they've had, I don't think, any repeat winners yet in the Extreme Outlaw Midget Series. So we'll talk with Carter Sarf a little bit later on, hour two exclusively on Racing Boys. Scott, we got a lot of late model racing going on in the area. Big weekend of racing. The MLRA opening up down at Lucas Oil Speedway this weekend. Last night,
Jonathan Davenport win.
Boy, he's got that place figured out, doesn't he?
How many races has he won down there, Kurt?
He's won a ton. I don't have the exact number here, but he won two, three races there last year. He did not win the Show Me 100 last year. That honor went to Devin Moran after Ricky Thornton Jr. Was disqualified due to failing the droop test when he hit the wall and broke a bracket on the car that caused him to fail that droop test. But guess what? Ricky Thornton Jr. was at Lucas Oil Speedway last night.
Yeah.
So, and by the way, they honored Lloyd Collins this weekend. We all miss Lloyd, had his services. And I just want to say before we go to break, lost another good friend in racing, Scott, Steve Cabbage, who I worked with up at the Adams County Speedway in Corning. He was on the announce crew up there, did a lot of work up there on the announce crew up there. He passed away suddenly of a heart attack. Found that out while I was at Lloyd's service last Sunday. And so thinking about Steve Cabbage, good friend. They had his services this past weekend, this past week up in Iowa. So thinking of his family as well here. It's a sad time. We're losing too many friends here, Scott.
All right, no doubt about it. Listen, we want to say hi to Jerome, who is in South Dakota right now. So we want to thank all the people that listened from around the country right here on Sports Radio 810 WHB. It's all brought to you by Rod End Supply, featuring the Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprints. When we come back, David Gravel joins us next right here on Track Talk.
Track Talk.
Rod End Supply is involved with a variety of motorsports as well as industrial applications with many different types of products. Since 1989, Rod End Supply has provided superior products priced competitively. Whether you're racing at the circle track or drag strip, rock climbing, or going off-road, Rod End Supply has an assortment of rod ends, radius rods, and specialty products to keep your equipment moving. Rod End Supply's experienced staff is ready and willing to help you with your needs. Their promise is to continue to provide a superior product with superior service so you can stay in front of the field no matter what it is. To learn more, go to Rod End Supply.
It's Todd Lebo here for Serta Pro Painters. If you're like me, your home is your happy place. You spend a lot of time there. It's a point of pride, and you want it to look great. When it comes to a big project like painting, don't do it yourself. Call the pros at Serta Pro Painters. Each Serta Pro Painters business is independently owned and operated right here in the KC Metro. You can schedule a free estimate online at SertaPro.com. That's Serta with a C. Now, they've always done a great job for me, both inside and outside of my home. We're due for a new exterior paint job, so we're getting on the Serta Pro Painter schedule this spring. I know it's going to be smooth as silk, from the bid to the color selection to the work itself, right on through cleanup. Serta Pro Painters always knock it out of the park for me, and they will for you too. You can trust Serta Pro Painters to get the job done right and safely. For your home or your business, now is the perfect time to get on the exterior schedule or knock off an indoor project as well. Get that free estimate online at SertaPro.com. When choosing a painting professional, the choice is simple. Choose happy. Choose Serta Pro Painter.
Hey, Soren Petro here. You've heard me talk about my collection of sports jerseys. I'm very proud of them. And there's only one place I trust to frame them. Art and Frame Warehouse at 92nd and Metcalf. Locally owned and operated, they've been in business for 20 years. And they specialize in jerseys and sports memorabilia. They offer the best customer service. Give you gallery quality at warehouse prices. For samples of their work, go to FrameKC.com. Mention 810 to get major discounts on memorabilia and shadow boxes. For the best in framing, trust Art and Frame Warehouse. Online at FrameKC.com.
You can keep your grass green and lush all year long with a new sprinkler system from Summit Lawn and Landscape. Call Summit Lawn and Landscape today at 816-966-9434 to design a water-efficient system for your home and never drag a hose again. 816-966-9434. Summit Lawn and Landscape provides complete lawn maintenance, including mowing, fertilization, and landscape installation, maintenance, and design. Call 816-966-9434 or go to summitlawn.com.
April is here, and with springtime weather, it's important to have quality windows. If yours won't open to let in that fresh air or won't seal tight to keep out the pollen and bugs or have been leaking water all winter, then it's time you talk to the experts at Window Nation. Right now, for every two windows you buy, you'll get two windows for free. There's no limit to how much you can save. Plus, you can save even more with no interest or payments for 24 months. Window Nation's windows come with a lifetime warranty, and they can be installed in a day or less. With proven quality and service, when you buy from Window Nation, you can rest assured you're getting affordable windows that meet or beat the ones from the national brand names. Don't miss out on your chance to afford quality windows with an unlimited buy two, get two free, plus zero interest or payments for 24 months. You can't afford to wait. It's easy. Call 866-90-NATION or visit windownation.com to schedule your free in-home estimate.
For the latest on the Kansas City Royals, keep it right here on Sports Radio 810 WHB.
Starting pitching's been dynamite. The only runs you give up coming from your starting pitchers, and at that, only 10 earned? Goodness. Like, that is the recipe.
Kansas City's home for the All-Star Game, the Major League Playoffs, and the World Series. Sports Radio 810 WHB.
Welcome back. It's Track Talk here on Sports Radio 810 WHB. It's all brought to you by Rod End Supply, featuring the Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprints. Kirk, we had a chance to talk to David Gravel on Monday on Mostly Motorsports.
And that was after he won at US 36 Raceway a week ago last night. His second place finish down in Arrowhead Speedway last Saturday night. And before last night's win at Federated I-55 Speedway. And so Peedley. Here is the conversation that we had with David Gravel earlier this week on Mostly Motorsports.
That was kind of a thrilling victory for you up there, wasn't it?
That's an intense racetrack, extreme banking. You know, maybe not the best catch fence, so it takes a lot of courage there. But luckily he was around the bottom and not around the top banging the boards. And it was an interesting race. There was a lot of cautions and red flags and open reds. And luckily we were able to put ourselves in position and inherited the lead and didn't give it up.
You know, you're the first two-time winner of the 2024 season. You take a little pride in that?
Obviously, you know, that's good. Sheldon won the next night, and he's a two-time winner as well. So, I mean, it's a long year, but it's nice to get a couple victories in the win column. You never want to get behind in that win column. So if you stay on the front side of the wins, it's definitely a good feeling, and hopefully there's many more to come.
You've got a 40-point lead over Donnie Schatz right now in the point standings, and Giovanni Selzy is currently third. Logan Schuchart is fourth, and Carson Macedo is fifth. You got to feel pretty good about your season so far this year, right?
Yeah, for sure. You know, if we could redo one night so far, we would. But we got into a wreck that night, had to go in the work area, and came back to 12th. But other than that, it's been a really, really, really strong season, and we've been pretty good every time we hit the racetrack. So it's been a great start. It's a long year, but we're just going to keep focus on what we could control and what we do, and you know, hopefully we end up on the right side of things.
Hey, did you feel like that you had something for Sheldon when he was out there leading the race? Did you feel like you had enough to maybe run him down a little bit?
Yeah, I thought so. I thought I was gaining on him and was kind of running a little bit different line than he was. So I felt confident in what we had and our chances to win no matter what happened, but it would have been cool to race it out, that's for sure.
All right, when you saw Sheldon get into Wyndham down there, down in turn one, how close were you? It looked like you almost got caught up in that.
Yeah, it was fairly close. You just don't know which way they're going to go when that happens. You know, are they going to, you know, stay on the throttle and do a 360 or drive down the track or lock up the brakes? So all that's happening is like, you know, split second decisions, and luckily we were able to get woed up and you know, dodge the wreck.
You know, at the end of that race, it seemed that you had a little problem with some lap cars. Can you kind of take us through that a little bit?
You know, lap cars are always difficult, especially the first couple ones, because they're the ones that are most off the pace and, you know, kind of get surprised by us. So when the track is pretty dominant in one lane, it makes it even harder. And, you know, you just got to be aggressively patient and, you know when it's the right time to try to put that guy away or when you should maybe follow the guy for a corner.
Yeah. Let's talk about when you went down there to the Jason Johnson Classic. That racetrack, it really kind of took rubber, and it was kind of almost like pavement racing, wasn't it?
Yeah, the last 10 to 12 laps was, you know, rubber down, and glad they shortened the race up or nobody would have made it on tire wear. So, yeah, great facility, has a lot of potential. Looking forward to how that place evolves, but you know, they probably never had 33, 410 wing sprint cars there, you know, wearing on a racetrack. And,
right.
But it's not even hot either. So they got some learning to do. But I think with a little bit of practice, they could probably get it better for the rest of the night. But very impressed with the facility.
You started sixth. You ended up running second. Did you feel like that you had anything for Sheldon on down there at the Jason Johnson Classic?
Yeah, I kind of conserved my tires the last eight or so laps, and saw the flag men counting the laps down, and there at the last lap, I thought I had a really good shot to get by them, just wasn't able to make it happen. So, yeah, it just didn't work out, but I definitely thought I had a real shot again getting it done.
Hey, so let me tell you, when do you notice that the tire is going down? During that red flag, did the crew come out, and when they put fuel in the car, did they tell you that your right rear was getting kind of puny?
We didn't have an open red on the Jason Johnson Classic race. That was at US 36.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
As far as as far as tire wear and stuff, you just start losing grip and the tire gets softer and softer and it rolls over on the right rear more and more. And you just know that there's not much left there. So you just try to conserve and, you know, try not to go too slow, but definitely don't try to wear your stuff out either.
I'm sorry, I get confused on the races from back-to-back races there at the Jason Johnson Classic versus the U.S. 36 Raceway. Did you feel like that open red helped you a little bit up there at U.S. 36 Raceway?
I don't know if the adjustments helped or hurt me. It helped me in one end and made me worse in another, so it was kind of a cause-and-effect moment. So, you know, it looked like that we, you know, won by a little bit of a margin, so I wouldn't say it hurt.
Of course, David, those of us who are here in Kansas City remember that race at Lakeside Speedway last fall when you got that late restart with Donnie Schott sitting behind you. You don't take anything for granted now, do you?
Any outlaw race, you know, nothing's handed to you. They're all earned, and you got to be on point every lap, so... these deals aren't easy to come by, and that's why it's a very rewarding feeling when you can get the job done.
Let's look ahead. You're going to be over at I-55 Federated Auto Parts Speedway, Peabody, this weekend. That is a racetrack that's built for wing sprint cars. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, Peabody's an exciting track. This time of year, you just never know what you're going to get as far as track conditions with it could rain a lot or not, and, you know, we just have to see what it brings. But hopefully we could get two more nights of racing in and have a good weekend.
Yeah, this time of the year, you just don't know what kind of weather you're going to get. That is for sure.
For sure.
You know, when you take a look at the crew, you know, crews are – it's hard to get solid this day and age to try to keep a good crew on board. That's a big challenge for a lot of these race teams out there to keep a good crew together. You seem to got the right mix of people in place now to go for this championship.
Yeah, it's one of the hardest things in our sport right now is keeping crew guys around. It's a lot of sacrifice, and it's not an easy job. You're away from home a lot, and it just... when you have good guys, you definitely want to take care of them so they stick around. And, you know, Donnie Schatz and Tony Stewart and Ricky Warner, you know, built a little dynasty there, and they kept the same core guys together for a long time. And I just think that's what it takes to have sustained success.
What is it going to take to outrun Donnie Schatz for the championship this year? Because he's the guy that's 40 points back. I think it's going to come down to you and him. I can't count out Gio as well and Logan Schuchart, but those guys are kind of right there all in the same mix, 40, 58, 68 points out. So what is the biggest challenge to you winning the championship this year?
It's just a long year. It's a lot of races, a lot of different racetracks. You know, we haven't even gotten to our normal racetracks yet, you know, so – I don't think there's really been a telltale for the year yet. It's too early. We're going to all these tracks in Oklahoma and stuff that we've never been to, or our oddball stuff in Texas and stuff. So,
right.
You know, once we get to Eldora and Sharon and Williams Grove and Lincoln and Attica, you know, get to our normal tracks, you know, that then we'll kind of see where everybody's at and where it shakes out.
Have you noticed any difference at all in the change of the rule in the Wicker bill going from the 2-inch down to the one inch? Has that made any difference at all with you behind the wheel of these race cars?
I mean, it definitely less grip when it gets slick. And then, you know, when you're behind guys, you have less traction just because you have less downforce. So it's been a little bit different, but, I mean, not a lot. But I feel like we got our handle on it pretty good right now. And again, we're going to see what kind of big difference it makes when we get to a real slick Eldora or get to Attica where it's really slick. You know, a lot more will be shown there.
Yep.
And what about tires? Last year, there was a big change in tires. Some adjusted to it. Others did not. Has that been any factor at all this year? Everybody got a pretty good handle on the tires?
Yeah, I think the tires are, the same after they changed them there in the beginning of the year. And I think everybody's got a pretty good handle on them, it seems like. So, they could change throughout the season, too. They kind of change things and don't tell you sometimes, and you got to be on your toes for that when it happens.
All right, there you have it. David Gravel joining us on Mostly Motorsports on Monday after his victory up at US 36 Raceway, and that was a thrilling victory up there as well, wasn't it, Kirk?
Yeah, and then, of course, last night he wins again.
Right.
So he's a hot driver right now. It's been a while since he had won at I-55. I think, what did he say, 2017 was his last win over at Peabody?
2016.
16.
Okay. 2016,
yep.
His last win up there
been
at
a
US
while.
36. Yep. He's got 3 wins on the year. He's got 5 top 10s and 11 top 5s out of 12 races. That's pretty good stuff right there.
It is. And one other driver you want to keep your eye on is Sheldon Haudenschild. I thought maybe he might have a better finish than he did last night, even though he was up in the top 10. He normally runs good at that racetrack.
All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, more of Track Talk right here on Sports Radio 810 WHB. It's all brought to you by Rod and Supply, featuring the Power Iowa Midwest Lightning Sprints. We'll be back with more right here on Sports Radio 810 WHB in a moment. Stay tuned.
Track Talk. Rod and Supply is involved with a variety of motorsports as well as industrial applications with many different types of products. Since 1989, Rod and Supply has provided superior products priced competitively. Whether you're racing at the circle track or drag strip, rock climbing, or going off-road, Rod and Supply has an assortment of rod ends, radius rods, and specialty products to keep your equipment moving. Rod and Supply's experienced staff is ready and willing to help you with your needs. Their promise is to continue to provide a superior product with superior service so you can stay in front of the field no matter what it is. To learn more, go to Rod and Supply.
The temperatures are heating up, which means more backyard cookouts on your smoker and grill. The Kansas City Barbecue Store at I-35 and 119th Street in Olathe is your one-stop shop for all you need to get your food from the grill to the table. The barbecue store is stocked with seasoning, sauces, rubs, fuel accessories, and even fresh prime whole briskets. Stop in today to check out the new Gosney pizza ovens and ABS smokers, all locally made. The Kansas City Barbecue Store is open 7 days a week at I-35 and 119th Street, right across the lot from Joe's KC in Olathe.
Enjoy a full year of fun with a membership to the Kansas City Zoo and Aquarium. Open daily, year-round, each visit is a new adventure. Your membership includes unlimited visits for an entire year, discounts on concessions, retail, and select events. Home to nearly 10,000 animals representing over 400 species, there's so much to see. Purchase your membership online at kansascityzoo.org this month and get an extra month free. Use code FREEMONTH at kansascityzoo.org.
Choice for lawyers and important decision and should not be based solely upon advertisements.
Paid for simulated client portrayal.
I'm attorney Mike DiPasquale. No matter how you've been injured, my law firm is here to help.
Mike and his team handle all kinds of cases.
Big truck accidents and wrongful death cases.
Even defective product cases. Any kind of case, Mike's got this.
No matter what kind of injury case you have, I promise we can help. Call me. I've got this.
Mike's got this. All you need to know. 816-888-7500. Mike's got this.
Mitsubishi seconds. Electric heat pumps are going mainstream. With tax credits of up to $2,000, the Federal Inflation Reduction Act can make it more affordable than ever to upgrade your HVAC system and lower your energy bill. Now's the time to say goodbye to your old system and switch to a qualified all-electric, all-climate heat pump from Mitsubishi Electric. Precision room control is easier than ever. Mitsubishi Electric also has the new whole home option with the IntelliHeat Hybrid Dual Fuel Heat Pump. For more info, visit KeepKCCool.com. That's KeepKCCool.com. And don't forget to ask about the new IntelliHeat Whole Home option. It's great. That's KeepKCCool.com.
All right, welcome back. It's Track Talk here on Sports Radio 810 WHB.
Did you see that finish at Farmer City last night, Scott? The late model race between Nick Hoffman and
Bobby Pierce. That was
How
a crazy finish, wasn't it? Down the front straightaway, over the lip, grinding it out. That was a hell of a finish, wasn't it?
Yeah, and Bobby Pierce thought he had won, so he goes to victory lane, only to find out that the transponder, and I'm not sure where the transponder was in relation to the camera.
Right.
But the transponder clearly had Nick Hoffman, the winner of that race. So he said, well, if the transponder says that, then Nick won. Congratulations to him.
Right.
What a wild finish that was.
That was a great finish last night. And Andrew Deal is going to be running for Rookie of the Year with the ASCS National Sprint Car Tour. Did you hear that, Kurt?
Yeah, I heard that. So I saw that article. We had that up there.
And that's on our homepage as well.
Yep.
Right.
So next weekend they get things going in the ASCS. So we'll see how things go. We'll be able to watch that on Dirt Vision now that the World Racing Group owns ASCS.
Right. Let's bring on our next guest. Blake Housley joins us now here on Track Talk on Sports Radio 810 WHB. Blake, how you doing?
Good, sir. How are you guys?
Hey, we're doing pretty good, man. From what I hear, the reviews yesterday were fantastic about the drag strip. What do you think?
Yeah, we had a great day. I mean, we got a great group of racers supporting us. Yesterday, everything went about as good as it could. Our staff here has worked hard. Scott Higgs, who's the owner, put all this together, and he's put the right people in place. He didn't skimp on anything as far as the surface, the facility, and it's really turned out top-notch. We had some of the fastest runs. Everybody was running career best yesterday. We had a pro mod go 358 at 220. We had a jet car run 280 mile an hour on the first day. The main thing is all our racers, we all worked together. Everybody had a great day, and everybody seemed to enjoy it. They came out.
It looked like they laid down a lot of rubber yesterday on the racetrack. Is that correct?
Well, we had been started. Kurt Johnson at TVC, Total Venue Concepts, he come in. He's the one that's kind of managed the project for us. He came in about a week ago and just kind of started putting a base of rubber. And our staff here started last Saturday, and we've probably spent 50 hours on it. Our tractors have what they call a rotator, which basically has a 9-inch forward with two chains, and it rotates tires backwards. So and when we're driving on the racetrack with our tractors, we put load on those tires, and it applies rubber to the track. So we worked and worked hour after hour, and we drag it for a while, then we spray VHT, which is a traction compound, and it's just a slow process, and we've all worked hard because we want our racers to have what they deserve when it comes time to run on it.
Blake, for those that are tuned in, don't know who you are, you're a pretty accomplished pro mod racer yourself. And you've been in the Kansas City area for a number of years now. Just tell us how you and Scott Higgs came together to build this racetrack. We've been without a drag strip here in Kansas City since
forever.
2011.
Right.
Yeah, so Scott Higgs, I used to work at Terry Murphy Race Cars. Scott Higgs come in there to have a car worked on, and we went to the racetrack and ran, and we had to go all the way to Tulsa to test. Well, the first time we had a little bit of problems, and we just new car blues, had to go all the way back down there again. And we was at dinner that night, and he said, "Man," he said, "why don't you?" This is how it started. I just might as well tell you. He said, "Let's get your car back out." I said, "It got so expensive. We kind of got an older engine, and we're just kind of going to take a step back." Well, he said, "Well, no, we're not going to do that." He said, you help me. Let's team up and start racing together. Which we did that in 2020. Well, COVID hit, kind of delayed everything. And then last December, we got approached to, or Scott got approached about buying this land. He's like, "Man," he said, "I think it'd be good to bring drag racing back to Kansas City." And we kind of tried to talk each other out of it for 4 or 5 months, it felt like. And then Scott, he's just a very determined, very successful businessman. He said, "You know what? I think we can make this work. I want to do it." And I said, "Well, it's going to be a lot of work, but if you want to do it, I'll have your back 100%. And we kind of just took off and ran with it. And we all had to learn on the fly on what to do, a lot of things, but we have a lot of good employees we've hired, a lot of good help from our contractors and stuff. And everybody's just done their job. And Scott's pushed to get this deal done. We didn't even start moving dirt till roughly May 1st last year. And to have a racetrack now, it's pretty unheard of the way things are nowadays.
Now, this is a unique situation. Chris Payne, who owned Heartland Motorsports Park, developed this land for the dirt track. And, of course, we all have a lot of history of the old I-70 Speedway out there.
Yep.
So he developed this, and he had original plans to build a drag strip, but did get the dirt track refurbished. Just how you and Chris Payne, how did that all work out to make this happen on that particular piece of property?
Well, Chris Payne, he's partnered with Steve Bailey over here on the round track. They actually, I'm not really sure how the first initial contact got. I think it was a mutual friend, and they kind of approached us about him, Scott, possibly coming in and helping build a drag strip. And when Scott's like, I really don't want partners per se. He said, we could be okay and multi-use the facility, but I'd be interested in buying the land. And we bought the and Scott bought the land, and Chris and Steve have worked with us throughout the whole thing, and we agreed to be good neighbors, and we all work together, and it's kind of made a multi-use facility here that's really turned into something special, I feel like.
Hey, let me ask you this, Blake. When I was out there, when they went through the process, they said that there wasn't going to be any nitro cars, and I understand that in 2025 they're going to have a national event out there. How did that process come together?
So there was a noise issue that originally they thought it came up, and we've worked and we're still working with the county. We're trying to be respectful of our neighbors and really going to work with everybody. But you think about it, a nitro car, they're the loudest thing they are, but they only run for 3.8 seconds.
Right.
You know what I mean? So as you ever do it, and they run, they have about 16 of them, which is eight pair. When there's two classes, so that's 16 pairs, and it gets narrower as the day goes on. So on the qualifying, most you have 32 pairs of cars. Well, times 4 seconds, that's not much time of actual noise.
That's
you know
correct.
What I mean?
Yeah.
Because
yep.
The noise level is an average over so many minutes. So it's not, and like I said, we're going to be respectful. And that's tentatively a national event in 2025. We still got some development process. We got more pits to pave and other things to do. But that's the ultimate goal. None of us want to see Heartland close. It was good for the area to have that style, that big of drag race, and have an NHRA national event in the area. So we're hoping we can do what we got to do, and we can show that we can be cordial neighbors and take care of our people around here, and the county will work with us, and we'll get all this worked out, and we can have it here next year, hopefully.
NHRA, I know for a fact, covets the Kansas City market, and they worked tirelessly to keep that going over at Topeka, but we know they really covet the Kansas City market, and just a matter of time before you can make this happen here in Kansas City. So I would assume that NHRA is all in whenever that time comes, that you'll have a big-time national event.
Absolutely. I mean, NHRA's third Division 5 office, which is, covers Missouri, Iowa, Nebraska, Minnesota, North and South Dakota,
right,
Kansas. They've actually lost a lot of tracks. They've, with Heartland closing, you had Denver closing. That was one of their tracks. And also Great Bend, Kansas was another one of their tracks. So this area, they need it as bad as we, as all our racers did. And they're Rob Park, who has been a division director for 20-something years there, who's recently retired to other position, but he's been big in this. Nick Duty and their staff, who is the division director now, they come out yesterday and helped us do things. And, racing's changed, over the years.
Right.
And in this area, there's a lot of racers that haven't run NHRA legal type stuff. You know what I mean?
Right.
And because they haven't had a track. I mean, they had Topeka, but it was kind of, they did a lot of specialty stuff over there. So they've helped us kind of help starting to bridge that gap. You know what I mean? Kind of make all our racers come back in. Yeah. They've just been a big help to us get this facility going.
What is the economical input on the city? Have you guys done any research on that? And what is that going to bring to the city financially?
Oh, it's going to be huge. I mean, there's not many hotels or restaurants right here close to us. We're 15, 20 minutes away. Oak Grove is really the closest chain hotel. They have all the express suites out there. But Blue Springs ain't a bad drive. It's 20 miles, but it's going to be huge. We got some I got some numbers. I don't have them in front of me, but it's very huge to the area. You know what I mean? I mean, down to the local gas stations, they're going to see a big boom. You know what I mean? It's just going to be it's going to be really good for us, and it's going to be a good for this area, I feel like. We're far enough out, I don't feel like we're going to be bothering anybody, but we're not too far out that everybody can't go enjoy a nice dinner or go get a hotel and come from all areas. We're pretty close to, even like Wentzville, Jeff City, Columbia. I mean, that ain't a horrible drive. You know what I mean? You're talking
right.
An hour and a half
yep.
drive. So, there's a lot of big areas around. We got racers here from Nebraska, I mean, Kansas, Oklahoma, Arkansas, just yesterday for a test and tune. I mean, you bring that people from that far out. We kind of feel like a 400-mile radius is what a guy could cover. A big promoter, Bill Bader, has one of the most successful drag strips in the country. He said that 400-mile radius, you should be able to pull people in. He said, I know that sounds like a lot, but that's a day's drive and then come spend a weekend. And, right. And you think about a 400-mile radius, we can draw that type of people into this area. It's a huge economic impact for the whole area.
Are you going to add grandstands to the other side of the drag strip?
So we have grandstands on site, to add more. We have 10,000 seating, right now. On the right side there, there's going to be another big video board. It's going to be 14 by 21. So, like our school board, we have another billboard over there on the so we can advertise and do everything else. So we're thinking about putting about a 300-foot row of bleachers on the right, 200 to 300-foot row of bleachers possibly. But we also want to be able to have RV parking on that right side with power spots to park rigs on the right side, so you can rent a spot, bring your motorhome or camper up here, pull it up the track, and just stay there the whole weekend and watch and have a great weekend.
Hey, Blake, I was impressed with the construction of this racetrack. You brought in some really big experts to design and construct this racetrack. Just kind of talk about this. It's a world-class drag strip.
Yeah. I mean, it starts with Steve Bailey. He come in and did all the dirt work, cat excavating. He's just done a great job here. Mount Carmel Stabilization come in. A.W. Oaks come all the way out of Wisconsin to pour the walls and pour the concrete because Kurt Johnson had worked with them at Total Venue Concept, who was the manager of the project and knew how it needed to be done. Superior Asphalt done all the asphalt. Superior Electric did all the electrical work here. Impact Signs out of Sedalia, they're the ones that designed the video board. So we worked with a lot of local companies, but we've also stretched out to that we feel like we've got the best of the best doing this.
Right.
Casey Structural Steel did the tower, and they just did an unbelievable job on that. I mean, everybody that's come in has just done above and beyond because, you know, I think everybody feels the need and wants to, you know, they haven't been a quarter-mile racetrack built in, I think somebody said yesterday, 25 years. So, I mean, we all know we need racetracks, whether it's round tracks, drag strips, road courses. We don't need to see any going away, and we need to celebrate every new one that's built. And right. I'm not just saying that's because of the owner here. I just think all racing, we need to realize that, you know, everybody kind of had complained about KCR or Topeka.
Right.
Well, you know how it goes throughout the years, but when it's gone, you realize how much you miss it. So I've been there before. Back when I lived in Tennessee, we had a racetrack we couldn't go within 4 hours and even test. So,
right.
Have this place like this, I think it's going to be really good for our racers. I think it's going to be a huge deal.
Blake, we can't thank you for taking the time to join us here on Track Talk. We appreciate it. It's all brought to you by Rod End Supply, featuring the Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprints. Thanks so much for taking the time. We appreciate it.
Thank you, guys. We really appreciate it. Hope to talk to you again and see you guys out here.
Yeah, next time we get you on, we'll talk about your racing. So
yes, sir.
We'll
thank
do it again.
Much.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Blake.
Good guy.
Man,
how about that?
I am so pumped up about the new drag strip out there at I-70 Motorsports Park. Are you excited about that?
Oh, yeah. You know, I'm really impressed by their approach they're taking at this, one step at a time. They're building this thing.
30,
they're not ready to host
seconds.
A national event yet, so there won't be one in 2024. And I think that's smart to make sure they got everything in place.
And they're going to add grandstands to the other side as well.
They're doing this the right way.
Yep, no doubt about it.
They got activity out there all day today. Tomorrow, no prep racing at Flying H Drag Strip, so check it out. Odessa is back in business in the racing world. How about that?
It is great to see the Flying H Speedway out there at I-70 Motorsports Park. I'm so pumped up about it. I can't wait to get out there and maybe watch a little drag racing today.
That was so cool to watch those cars go down the track. And he updated that number, 350 for a pro mod yesterday.
Right, yep.
How
no
about
doubt.
That?
Thanks, everybody, for tuning in to Track Talk here on Sports Radio 810 WHB. Don't forget, hour number two exclusively on our Facebook page and YouTube. Or you can watch it on racingboys.com as well. So we hope that you'll join us hour number two. Want to thank everybody back there at Sports Radio 810 WHB, Todd Surprise here at RBN, the Racing Boys Broadcasting Network. For my partner, Kirk Elliott, I'm Scott Traylor. We'll see you next week right here on Track Talk.
Rod and Supply is involved with a variety of motorsports as well as industrial applications.
Rock and Roll Man Perfect.
Types of products. Since 1989, Rod and Supply has provided superior products priced competitively. Whether you're racing at the circle track or drag strip, rock climbing, or going off-road, Rod and Supply has an assortment of rod ends, radius rods, and specialty products to keep your equipment moving. Rod and Supply's experienced staff is ready and willing to help you with your needs. Their promise is to continue to provide a superior product with superior service so you can stay in front of the field no matter what it is. To learn more, go to rodandsupply.com.
Thanks, Jay. Appreciate it, bro.
Race fans, Sports Radio 810 is proud to announce our partnership with Wholesale Batteries, Lewis Motorsports, Dakota Earls.
Rod and Supply is involved with a variety of motorsports as well as industrial applications with many different types of products. Since 1989, Rod and Supply has provided superior products priced competitively. Whether you're racing at the circle track or drag strip, rock climbing, or going off-road, Rod and Supply has an assortment of rod ends, radius rods, and specialty products to keep your equipment moving. Rod and Supply's experienced staff is ready and willing to help you with your needs. Their promise is to continue to provide a superior product with superior service so you can stay in front of the field no matter what it is. To learn more, go to rodandsupply.com.
Here at Specialty Sportswear, in-house, we do all of the screen printing, all the embroidery. We do some vinyl. The other add specialty items like your pens, magnets, notepads, calendars. You can actually buy that, build your business to make it larger. We have the largest screen printing process and the largest embroidery anywhere around in the area. We can do stuff all the way from your school clubs to sports teams, a professional look in the office. If you can imagine it, we can do it for you.
From the circle track to the drag strip to off-road racing, Rod and Supply has been keeping their customers at the front of the field since 1989. Whether you need rod ends, tubular rods, or specialty products, Bob Douglas and his Rod and Supply staff are always ready to help you with your needs. You can visit them on the web at rodandsupply.com or call them at 800-284-2902. That's 800-284-2902. Rod and Supply. Keeping you at the front of the field.
When Steve died, the outpouring of love was amazing. These dollars had come together to support us, and we realized no, we didn't want to use them for us. We wanted to use them to help others.
The foundation has done so much for so many people. It helps any family that has somebody, whether it be a crew member or one of the drivers, that get hurt. We can help them to get through the situation.
I was injured in a non-wing sprint car accident that broke my neck and left me with a spinal cord injury. I was in the hospital 8 months, and that got really, really expensive. So having that extra help to help push me and my family forward was a big deal.
Yes, Steve's death is the reason the foundation exists, but it's Steve's life and it's the lives of racers everywhere is the reason we're able to do the work we do.
Signs attract half of all new customers. A vehicle wrap can get 30,000 views per day. On-site signage costs roughly 2 cents per view. At Impact Signs, Awnings, Wraps, we know signs work. Custom signs, interior or exterior, for any application. Commercial awnings, any shape, any size. Full-color video displays, time and temp boards, gas price changers, and scoreboards. We can wrap anything, vehicles, trailers, boats, and more. Check us out at impact4800.com.
Race fans, the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame and Museum is open 7 days a week, year-round, for you to come in and check out all of the wonderful race cars on display in the museum. And our online store at SprintCarStuff.com is open 24 hours a day for you to check out everything that we have in stock for Sprint Car fans. Whether it's for a birthday, anniversary, or Christmas, SprintCarStuff.com has it all. That's at the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame and Museum in Knoxville.
Go harder, faster, stronger with Rod and Supply. Whether you are running industrial, farming equipment, or a race car, Rod and Supply has the assortment of rod ends, radius rods, and specialty products that will help you lead the field in performance. Our superior design means our rod ends last longer and perform better, giving you the edge on the track and saving you money. Contact Rod and Supply or order online today at rodandsupply.com. We don't just sell them, we race them. Rodandsupply.com, serving the racing community for over 30 years.
Hey, everybody, this is Larry the Cable Guy. You are listening to RacingBoys.com, and if you're not, I swear to you, get in your truck or do something, but get the hell out of this country, because you don't belong in it if you don't listen to these fellas. Get her done.
It's time for America's most unique motorsport show, Track Talk, brought to you by Rod and Supply and the PowerEye Midwest Lightning Sprints. Here are the racing boys, Scott Traylor and Kirk Elliott.
Welcome back. Hour number two right here on RBN, the Racing Boys Broadcasting Network. Got a lot to talk about today. Carter Sarf is going to be joining us here in a little bit. And, man, that was a great conversation with Blake Housley, wasn't it?
Yeah. It's he's been in Kansas City for a number of years. I think a lot of people, of course, we talk mostly dirt track racing, circle track. We talk a little drag racing, covered the national events over at Topeka for a number of years. But we haven't talked a lot about this guy who is a pretty accomplished pro mod racer around the country. He's won a lot of pro mod races, and Todd has put one of the pictures of his
pretty sharp looking car,
Willys, up there on the screen.
Is that
right
his
now.
Car?
Yeah,
and he built that car too. So he's a big time racer. Knows where he comes from and knows what he's doing.
That is not
when he's gotten involved with this.
Yeah, no, that's not a cheap car, right?
No,
now.
No. There's some money tied up into that bad boy right there.
That bad boy right there is probably got about $250,000.
I was gonna say it's 200. It's north of 200,000. I bet you. You're right. Yeah. Hey, we didn't talk about the first hour, which we normally don't. But what'd you guys think about OJ passing away?
Well,
what'd you think about that? I mean, such a historic figure before all of his second life, I mean, when I was a little kid, OJ was OJ. He was on every TV show and every commercial,
right,
and was everywhere, and then afterwards, everybody was talking about, where were you the night that the Bronco chase happened? I'll tell you where I was at. I was at the Royals game. The Royals were going through a pretty good stretch of run at that time, and we were all at the Royals game. I had a friend who, not a friend, I knew a lady that worked there because we used to have tickets behind home plate where the Royals' wife sat.
Right.
So I was sitting there as I was leaving. I'm coming down the elevators to head out to the thing, and the lady running the elevator said, OJ's running. He's on the loose. And I said, what are you talking about? She said, they're looking for him, and he's running down the highway. So I got in my car. Back then, guys, there was only CNN was it. There
right.
was no other 24-hour news channels. But I remember getting home and turning that on, and he was, I drove all the way from Raytown all the way to Piper, and he was still driving. They were still in the middle of that chase.
Hey,
you know?
And fortunately for me, OJ got what he deserved.
Well, I like
to
you
be
said,
honest with you.
I agree. I just
he did 9 years in prison, didn't he?
Not for that. He was acquitted for his murder.
But for the
for stealing art,
for
he stole,
stealing it in
yeah,
Las Vegas, right?
Yeah, yeah. But yep. I mean, what a strange life OJ Simpson lived, man.
You know that
who would ever thought that he would turn out to be a criminal?
Well, it's just a strange life.
It's odd.
That Bronco chase, everybody remembers where they were when that went down. And I remember I was late to Lakeside Speedway that night. It was on a Friday night because I got caught up, as everybody else did, with the Bronco chase. Yep. I couldn't put it down. We all had the TV on, and I got to the racetrack late that night because of O.J. Simpson in the back of a Bronco.
Yeah. So what has come out recently in the last couple of days, a lot of stuff's kind of come out because people are not afraid to say about what. But did you hear the very most interesting one was the Bob Costas new interview that he talked about. Bob said that he got a call from OJ in the back of the Bronco, and Bob happened to be doing a live show at Madison Square Garden.
Yeah,
right?
No, he was Bob Costas was on NBC's coverage of the NBA Finals.
The Finals.
Between the Rockets and the New York Knicks. Madison Square Garden. And Bob Costas was doing live coverage. And I remember flipping over there and hearing a lot of that on NBC doing their live coverage of the Bronco chase.
Absolutely.
Todd, have you ever seen this with the spear flying by? It's like a round ball and two fighter jets chasing it.
Oh yeah, I have seen that. Yeah.
Have you seen that?
Yeah, I did. But
they interrupted the NBA game for the Bronco chase on NBC.
So what Bob Costas comes to find out, Bob and OJ had done a TV show together, guys. You know, Bob, they did the NFL show together. So apparently OJ, in the midst of all this stuff, tried to call Bob Costas in during this thing and wanted to talk to him. And when AC called the place and said, I want to talk to Bob, he says, Bob's not here. He goes, let me talk to Bob. He's screaming at him. He said, he's not here. He's in Madison Square Garden. Well, later on, somebody told Bob that he had gotten a call, and he never believed it. Well, when he called back to the office, sure enough, OJ had called him from the back of the Bronco. And he says, I don't know what I would have told him. He goes, who knows what would have, you know, how things might have been different, because him and OJ were very tight professionally. They knew nothing of each other off the thing. But I just thought it was kind of it's a sports type of thing and also a very cultural thing. You
and
know,
who could not forget that trial?
Well, yeah.
That everybody watched every day.
If the glove doesn't fit, you must quit.
Well, I went out to California to the NAMM show with my friend Eddie. NAMM show is a music merch, kind of like your PRI show,
right?
But for music. And we're in Anaheim, and we're out there. And this was back in the day, guys, when there were still record companies and A&R representatives, people that artists.
Capitol Records.
So you had an artist relations person. So my friend Eddie Pruitt and I, they sent down a couple ladies that were AR reps for Capitol and one for Sony Records. And they took us around the city and showed us the landmarks of L.A., right? And so we went to the Whiskey. We went to the Rainbow. We went up to the Hollywood sign. We went by Madonna's house. We went to all these the road where James Dean crashed. Well, she said, would you like to go by and see the big media storm that's going on right now? And so they took us to
OJ's house.
You couldn't actually get there because the way they had it blocked off.
Didn't they tear that house down?
Yeah, the house has since been torn down. But when we went through there, guys,
it was still
the
there.
Media was insane. It was like you've nothing that you'd ever seen before. Like you said, there was no CNN was only 24/7, but you had every media person from the world was camped out there. And we went through there, and they had. We couldn't get in there, but we went into where where Nicole lived, and they had that all blocked off as well. And we went through there, but like you said, what a cultural weird thing, man.
Do you think OJ murdered her?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah,
of course.
He got off on it.
But they made that a racial trial.
He made it about race. He paid those lawyers a lot of money.
He paid them all the. He even said in the.
They got him off.
They even said
It was money well spent by him.
Well, that's what he said. He goes, "I don't care what it takes." They were talking. He even said, "I don't care what it takes. How much it takes. This is my life we're talking about."
Because he would have got life in prison
definitely.
Who can never forget that when the verdict came down?
Oh my gosh.
Remember where we were when we saw that.
It's just crazy.
It shocked everybody. Everybody was shocked when they acquitted
him. So ESPN just replayed the OJ documentary, and you can only see it on, you only have to pay for it, but holy smokes, man. What a crazy turn of events. You asked about
what do you think when you heard the news OJ died?
Yeah.
Even though he was not convicted of murder, the way he's treated in the aftermath of his death, he just as well been convicted.
Yeah,
of murder,
you know,
because that's the way he's being treated now.
He was just a strange, like you said. I grew up with him. He was in movies and TV shows and on every commercial and he was also your. When you watch the Chiefs,
did you see how much he's worth?
Well, he was worth a lot, and those poor family never.
He's worth like $18 million.
Yeah, but that family never. The Goldman still can't get their money from him because the way he set up their trust. He would set up these fake accounts to shuttle the money through, and they would never get their money.
So. I always remember the dad. Yeah. The Goldman dad.
Yeah, Ron Goldman's dad.
Ron Goldman. Mm-hmm. And
he was pissed.
Everybody could understand why he was pissed.
Well, you know, he bought the rights to that book, the OJ, because OJ came out with a book that said, if I did
Kirk
it.
Kirk just said pissed.
He did, so you know it.
You can say that.
Hey, they had Lakeside Speedway was running last night. I think they had their main, I think they opened up for their, they had a, from what I'm reading online, great track. The track was really good. The facility looked great. And they said they had a lot of cars, and the place was packed. So what a great night.
Did we get a press release from them last night,
Did
Kirk?
Not. Did not get a press release. Well,
like I said, this was just from social media, from somebody that was there last night. I didn't even hear them running last night, but I do know that from a few people have been talking, everybody seemed to have a good time out there. I don't even know who won last night. So if anybody liked it. Comment on one of the chat rooms. We got three of them, two of them up right there. You can watch us on Facebook Live, YouTube Live.
Well, we can give you the winners.
There you go. How about that?
Of course, they don't have A mods out there any longer.
Nope. Like you said, we canned them and they're gone.
But they got B mods, and Stephen Clancy was the USRA B mod winner last night. Doug Keller in USRA stock cars. Looks like they only had three sport compacts last night. David Miller was the winner of that. Ethan Isaacs in E-Mods and John Snyder in Pure Stocks were the winners on opening night out at Lakeside Speedway.
We have to get those press releases.
I don't know if they put any press releases out.
Well,
I'm not sure they do.
We need to get them.
They had 16 Pure Stocks, 20 E-Mods, 19 USRA B mods, 21 USRA stock cars, and three sport compacts out at Lakeside Speedway. Of course, we're looking forward to the High Limit doubleheader coming up on May 3rd and 4th at Lakeside Speedway.
If they don't get more than three compact cars,
drop it.
Right.
So
we've dealt with that with the Grand Nationals before.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, we understand with the Grand Nationals held on for as well because Don raced a Grand National for so long. You know, Don's the owner of the track, so, I mean.
Big weekend down at Humboldt Speedway. Of course, last weekend, the King of America feature event was rained out. They have yet to reschedule that event. But this weekend, they've got the Battle at the Bullring at Humboldt Speedway. After Dan Ebert won the USRA A-Mod on Thursday night, last night they had the inaugural race of the Heartland Modified Tour down at Humboldt Speedway in conjunction with the Battle of the Bullring, and Terry Phillips comes through with the win. Of course, Terry and some of the other USMTS stars were at Lake Humboldt Speedway because the USMTS scheduled event down in Louisiana was canceled due to bad weather. So a lot of the heavy hitters for the USMTS that were there at the King of America last week returned to Humboldt Speedway the last couple of nights. And last night it was Terry Phillips.
Darren Fuqua with the winner. Ended up running second. Tyler Wolf was third. Dan Ebert was fourth. And Trevor Hughes was sixth. Or fifth,
yeah,
I should say.
Fuqua made a nice little run up through the field there to get second place. Much better racetrack last night than Thursday night. They had, of course, it's been windy around here the last few days, and it really caused a lot of problems with the track prep on Thursday night down there when Dan Ebert won. It rubbered and locked down on Thursday night, but, you know, I'm going to give the Johnny Allen and the folks passed down there with that heavy wind down there. It was hard to put a good racetrack down on Thursday night. But last night, a whole lot better. We had some good action all the way around the Humboldt Speedway last night. And they didn't have as – I don't think they had as much wind down there as they had on Thursday. But, hey, when that wind starts blowing – It's going to cause a big problem with track prep,
right.
And that's what they had down there on
Thursday
night.
Hey, Frog said, did you know that Johnny Cochran had O.J. stop taking his anti-inflammation drugs so his hands would swell up?
Yeah.
And it worked.
Oh, yeah. Well, of course he was on.
If it doesn't fit, you must have quit.
Right.
You got to go back and watch that documentary. It breaks down. They interview everybody that's still alive and right now, and it's pretty amazing.
But
man,
they made that whole trial about race.
Well, yeah, and
because the jury was.
Well, if you listen to the jury,
yeah,
we're gonna get back on this again. But the jury, three of the jurors that they talked to said, "Well, of course we it was payback for Rodney King." That was what they said.
Yeah.
Three of the jurors said that. So, but here's what I don't know. You remember who Norm McDonald is, right? The comedian.
Yeah.
You know, he got fired from Saturday Night Live because he wouldn't stop telling the OJ jokes. That's why he lost his job at Saturday Night Live.
Is that really?
Yeah.
Why he lost it?
Because he was the news guy. You know how they do the news part.
Right, yeah.
And he would read the news, and he relentlessly just told, and finally
just kept doing OJ jokes.
They were bad. I mean, very, and finally, one of the NBC executive, Nick Imbersol, whatever, and they canned him. But, yeah, like you said. Hey, did you watch that truck race last night, Kirk?
I did, but I just want to throw one more note in.
Okay.
We'll get to the truck race. One more note from Humboldt last night. Tyler Wolf, who we told you on last week's show, hit the wall hard at Humboldt, knocked one of the blocks out of the wall last week, and He didn't race that next night or next couple of nights down there. He went back home. He returned to Humboldt Speedway, came away with a third place finish last night. So, Tyler Wolf coming back to conquer Humboldt after, and I don't think anybody had ever seen this before, knock one of those blocks out of the wall. He hit that wall so hard.
Yeah, that's a hit hard
night down there. So it was good to see Tyler Wolf back at the racetrack last night. So, tonight. Down at Humboldt, they've got the big Battle of the Bullring feature event for the B-Mods and another round of the Heartland Modified Tour. So, pretty good group of cars showing up down at Humboldt last night. I don't think it's going to rain tonight like it did last week, so I think
we're
going to get the whole
be all right.
Show in.
Kyle Busch picked up the win last night at Texas, didn't he?
Yeah, you know, I've been bagging on the Craftsman Truck Series events you know, from the beginning of the year. It was a terrible race at the end of last year at Phoenix and also the season opener at Daytona. But I got to say, last night was a very entertaining NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series race at Texas Motor Speedway. Good battle between Kyle Busch and Christian Eckes last night. And I was entertained by that, I got to say. It was a good race. Busch, he had to work for it last night, holding off Christian Eckes to get the win down there in Texas.
That was a hell of a wreck right at the beginning of that race. Who was that driver? His car, he was out early. I mean, I think we were lap six, and this was a hell. I mean, look at this crash that we had, and they were already taking him back on the golf cart, and I thought, man, boy, it took him longer to get through driver introductions than his day was
right
on the track. I mean, unbelievable, man. It was, I mean, he literally hadn't even worked a sweat up yet, guys, and he was riding on that golf cart, and I felt bad for him because you know how long it takes you to get
Thad
ready.
Muffet.
Yeah, that's who it was. That's it. Let me tell Muffet. You something. The poor kid was on. He just had that dejected look like, God dang, man. Like,
that's too early.
Six laps in is right. Four laps in is just not the way you want to go.
Tyler Ankrum was the other.
Yeah, that was who the other
one
was.
Caught up in that mess. But the other driver that had a pretty good run last night was Nick Sanchez in the number two truck. We've seen him out here at Kansas Speedways, won a couple of ARCA races.
Yeah, he's
out
there.
He's one of the most impressive young drivers that's out there right now. So Nick Sanchez coming in behind Corey Heim. Heim was the other driver.
He's still in the truck series, Kurt.
No, in the ARCA series when he was
With ARCA.
I know, but he's in the truck series now.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
But he's a good driver.
Actually, it was a three-way battle for the lead through a lot of the latter portions of that race with Corey Heim being a part of that battle up there as well. Nick Sanchez and Christian Eckes all right there at the front of the field for the trucks. The Xfinity race today, Cup Series tomorrow down at Texas Motor Speedway.
You want to set up this Carter Sarf interview?
Carter Sarf is one of the many winners in the Extreme Outlaw Midget Series. We've not had a repeat winner yet in the Extreme Outlaw Midget Series after Ryan Timms won the feature event at Farmer City last night. Carter Sarf won a week ago last night at US 36 Raceway and was pretty impressive doing it. The following night at Sweet Springs, he finished eighth. Last night, he was in the top 10, but fell back to 12th at the end of the race. Monday on Mostly Motorsports, we had a conversation with Carter Sarf, the reigning Power Eye Midget Series champion. And here's a portion of that interview with Carter Sarf from Monday on Mostly Motorsports.
Man, that was an exciting battle between you and Cannon McIntosh, wasn't it, bud?
Oh, yeah, for sure.
You pulled that slide job on him right at the beginning, but he was able to get back around you. How were you able to make that move when you finally made the move to get around him for the lead?
Yeah, I just kept trying to get my momentum wound up around the top there. It's a super big racetrack for midgets, so we were hauling the mail, and we had the thing geared to build speed over time, and I just got a big run off 1 and 2 around the top and saw him lane change to go to the top, so I dove bomb it down in there, and our car was just so good, and it just stuck everywhere I wanted to go and was so maneuverable, and that final time it stuck, I just that thing just felt so good.
Carter, I've got to talk to you about that racetrack up there. That place is pretty fast, isn't it?
Oh, yeah.
How much that remind – you told me after the race the other night kind of remind you a little bit of Peevely, a track you've gotten a lot of laps around.
Yeah, Peevely and Spoon River and Canton, Illinois, back around home. Our stuff just seems to go really good on the big tracks, and they're really not even my favorite tracks, but we seem to do really good at them. And, yeah, I don't know. Our package just works really well with them.
Have you ever raced up at Eagle Raceway up there, Eagle, Nebraska? Have you ever raced at that racetrack?
Nope, I have not.
That racetrack is built similar to what's going on up at Eagle Raceway. I don't know if you know that or not, but when Mike Franks built that racetrack, he built it like Eagle Raceway, just so you know.
Oh, I gotcha.
And, you know, you come from Illinois, just... what is your background? How did you get started in racing to begin with?
I started racing in quarter midgets. One of our close buddies of my dad's actually got us into racing. None of my other family members have ever really been involved in racing. And Kent told me to come out to an arrive and drive. So we went to that. And actually, the first time it got rained out. So Kent was like, hey, you guys want to take this quarter midget home and Carter can, or I can run it around in the yard. So that's what we did. And dad said that I was hauling the mail in that thing and driving like a maniac. So
right.
It all fired off from there.
Carter, you're currently fourth in points. Are you going to run full-time with the Extreme Outlaw Midget Series? Is that what your plans are this year?
We're definitely going to try as much as possible. It just depends on Dad's business with work back at home. It's just me and him that run it. So I guess it just depends on how busy we are. But, yeah, we'd for sure. We'd for sure like to.
How much is it when it comes to just you and your dad running the team, that puts a lot of pressure on you guys, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's a lot of work. We've definitely gotten more used to it now, so it doesn't seem too bad. But, yeah, when Dad's running around selling egress windows, I'm in the race shop getting cars ready for the next race, and I do pretty much everything in the shop. I set up our own cars, do the motor maintenance, and just freeze that up to be able to go do things for the business.
You know, it, a lot of young guys do not work on their cars anymore, but you are one of those guys that works on your car.
Yep. Yeah, I enjoy doing it. I know a lot of kids don't usually work on the race cars, and the ones that do, I have a lot of respect for, because it's a lot of hard work and dedication, and yeah, I personally enjoy doing it. Makes it a lot more rewarding for me when we win a race.
Do you feel like it's an advantage to you working on your own car at some point?
Oh, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just knowing how everything works and knowing what to do with my shocks as the race goes on, and yeah, I think it's a huge advantage to a certain extent, and I know how to fix it, and then I guess if we don't do very good, it's on me too, so I can't blame it on anybody else.
So when you come in, you know what you need with the car, and you can tell your dad exactly what you need with the car when it needs an adjustment, correct?
Yeah. Me and Dad talk over some things and figure out what we want to do, and just bounce ideas off each other to try and make the thing better. And yeah, we seem to do a pretty good job. We still got quite a bit to learn and stuff to work on, but we're definitely not doing too bad.
You won the PowerEye Championship last year. How big of a deal was that, and how did that help you get the ride that you got down at the Chili Bowl? Because you opened up a lot of eyes down at the Chili Bowl this year.
Yeah, that championship was huge, and that was our main goal going into the 2023 season, was to win a PowerEye National Midget Championship, and it was a long, hard-fought battle, that's for sure. And the Briscoe deal at Chili Bowl, that actually was in the works after BC 39, so it was before we even won the championship. Me and Chase have been pretty good buddies for a while now, ever since we were teammates with Boss Factory Racing when they were running midget stuff. And I know we did good at BC 39, so they said they've had their eyes on me for a while, and they know that I work hard and work on my own race cars, so they just thought that I deserved an opportunity, and I greatly appreciate it.
I think that's a big advantage, working on your own race car. You're currently fourth in the points. You're 82 points out. Do you feel like you got a shot at winning this championship?
Yeah, for sure. Like I said, our stuff's been pretty good lately. We got a few things to work on the smaller tracks, but I think the big tracks, we've pretty much got it down. So it's just a matter of changing what we've been running on the smaller tracks and trying to figure out how to make the thing better.
Yeah, running for championships can be quite stressful, but you proved yourself and your team that you can pull that off by winning that PowerEye Championship last year. How do you approach each night out if you're going to go for championships versus just going out a lot of, you know, just like Outlaw, just picking and choosing where you're going to run, going for championship? How what's the difference in your approach versus just going out and trying to win any race on the schedule?
Yeah, for me, my mindset doesn't really change much. We just want to win races, and obviously, winning races comes along with the championship. So I seem to take pretty good care of equipment and stay out of trouble and drive smart. So, yeah, I just see it as we go out and win races, and the championship will come along behind us. So
that really makes a lot of sense if you think about it. Yeah, it takes a lot of stress out. If you go that way about it, the points will take care of itself if you just go win races, right?
That's all you got to do is win races.
That's it.
Yep.
How did you you look really talented out there on the racetrack, Carter. How did you learn? Did you pattern yourself out of any driver? You're a talented race car driver out there. Where did you learn to drive these cars?
Just seat time, I guess. Just a lot of races, a lot of practice, a lot of hard work and dedication, watching videos. I think just having seat time is the biggest thing, and learning what your race car is going to do and trusting your race car. And like I said before, I still have a lot that I feel like I can improve on and get even better. So I just got to keep racing and learn by my mistakes and hopefully get even better. So
there's no one driver that you've looked at that might have inspired you?
Well, Chase Briscoe for sure inspires me, because I feel like me and him are so alike. We're shy, down to earth. Chase grew up with his parents didn't have a whole lot of money, kind of like ours. And yeah, I just feel like I'm going down the same path as him. So I really look up to him, and he keeps me motivated and dedicated to keep going and not to give up.
Carter, we can't thank you enough for being on the show today. We so appreciate it. It's Mostly Motorsports. It's all brought to you by Rod End Supply, featuring the Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprints. Have you ever run a Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprint type of car, a 1200 car? Have you ever run one of those?
No, I've ran some D2 midget races, I think with IMRA and just some local stuff around us, but I haven't ran the Lightning Sprints yet, which I know when I ran them, there was a mixture of the Eco cars and the Lightning Sprints. So,
I was thinking about it. I think Chase Briscoe won a Tulsa shootout in one of those cars one year, did he not?
I think he did.
I think he did, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, he raced those for quite a while.
Yep. Carter, we can't thank you enough for taking the time to join us here on Mostly Motorsports. We can't thank you enough for doing so. We're rooting for you, and hopefully you can win this championship here in the Extreme Outlaw Midget Series standings. Hopefully we can.
Yeah, hey, yeah, I really appreciate it, and appreciate you guys having me, and thanks for everyone for tuning in.
Hey, before I let you go, I want to ask you about Sweet Springs the other night. You started well back of where you did on Friday night up at US 36. Just kind of talk about that race. You slipped out of the top 10, got yourself back up into, I think you finished eighth in that race. Just talk about Sweet Springs on Saturday night.
Yeah, we struggled there quite a bit, actually. You know, heat race time, I think we just had the thing too free, and the two Coons cars were really fast, so we ended up third in our heat race, and had a start, and I think we started eighth in the feature. And we got the car quite a bit better. I think it was just a matter of me being too patient early. On small tracks like that, I get it in my head that I want to finish, and you know how the first five laps of a midget race are. It's insanity. So I think just in the future, I just need to be aggressive from the get-go and not let myself fall backwards in the beginning.
So what was it like going from the US 36 Raceway to Sweet Springs? That was a big, drastic difference, wasn't it?
Yeah, quite a bit. Sweet Springs felt slow. So, it's crazy. You run a bunch of small tracks, and they feel fast, and you go to a big track, and it feels really fast and gets your heart rate going, and then you come back to a little track, and you're like, oh, we're not going that fast anymore. So, yeah, it's definitely a huge change, and the big tracks, I don't know. Our package just works really good on the big tracks. We just got to figure out the smaller tracks.
So where will we find you next on the racetrack? What's up next for you?
Farmer City Raceway this weekend with Extreme. So hopefully the rain stays away and we can get that one in. That one's less than an hour from our house, so I'm excited to be racing around home.
That is Carter Sarf, and, you know, he's talking about having to figure out these smaller racetracks. And, you know, last night was kind of proof of that at Farmer City last night. He qualified fifth out of eight cars in one of the three qualifying sessions last night. So that's going to put you behind the eight ball right out of the gate. And if you get transferred out of your heat races, that's going to mean still you're going to have to start too far back in the A main to really make a big challenge of it. And Carter Sarf struggled a little bit last night. He had his car in the top 10 there in the later laps, but slipped to 12th right there at the beginning. So even though they've been good on the bigger racetracks, the high-speed racetracks like US 36 Raceway, it's not a big track, but it's fast.
Right.
The smaller bull rings, they've got a little bit of work to do to get things together. But he's a championship caliber driver. He won the Power Eye Championship last year, so anybody that can prove to go out and win a championship will eventually get these shorter tracks figured out. But Carter Sarf is, I think, you talk to everybody. He is a young guy still, 21 years old, but he's a pretty talented driver.
Oh, no doubt about it. Listen, Kirk, the high limit race at Texarkana was canceled due to floods, right?
That's that. I guess floods and Texarkana 67 seem to be way too off an occurrence here lately. The short track nationals last year, the first time it got rained out, and then they never did get it in. And weather is a big problem in Texarkana, Arkansas here over the last 6 months, it seems. So last night they weren't able to get the high limit race in. But tonight they're at Fort Worth at Texas Motor Speedway Dirt Track. And I'll be interested tuning in tonight, Scott, to see what kind of condition that racetrack is in. They don't race on that track
that often. That track, as my experience going down there to that racetrack, that track typically takes rubber.
Yeah. It seems abrasive. Seems like that track is always hard on tires.
It's terrible on tires.
Yeah. Now, I understand that they brought some people in to really do some work on that racetrack, and they've taken a little bit more of an effort to rework that racetrack, and how that's going to pay off tonight, I guess we'll find out when they get the cars out on the racetrack to see what kind of shape that track's in. I don't know what's going to happen. Also, car count, I'm going to be interested to see how many cars show up down at Texas Motor Speedway Dirt Track tonight. Last night, 41 cars at the World of Outlaws show at Peabody. That's a big number.
That was a good number.
So tonight is the first night that we're going to see the High Limit and the World of Outlaws running on the same night. And it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out in terms of car count for both these series running on the same night.
What'd you think about Jonathan Davenport winning last night?
Boy, he has Lucas Oil Speedway figured out, doesn't he?
He does.
He started up front, and really no one challenged Jonathan Davenport last night. And, of course, he's in line now to win that $20,000. It's up for grabs tonight in the season opener for the MLRA.
Ricky Thornton Jr. put a little pressure on him right there at the end of the race, though.
Yeah. Yeah, Thornton's always going to be fast. Of course, we all remember the Show Me 100 last year where Thornton won the race got DQ'd because of the
droop rule.
Failing the droop rule. And everybody agrees that was when he hit the wall and broke the bracket on that car that caused him to fail that droop test.
I thought
Kevin Moran was credited with the win.
I thought when Ricky Thornton Jr. got to second place, I thought he was going to pass Jonathan Davenport.
You did.
Uh-huh.
It looked at right after the start, it looked like there might have been a chance that Thornton could get underneath of him, but Davenport was able to slide up and take his line away right away. And once that happened, I don't think Thornton was going to have a shot at him. I'll tell you who had a
Mason Ziegler was pretty fast.
That's
as
just
well.
Who I was going to bring up.
Right.
Mason Ziegler had a fast race car last night. And he looked like he might have had something to challenge for the win last night. Big move up for Mike Marler, who started 15th in the race and ended up seventh. Mm-hmm. And, boy, he's had a good run of races here in the last, wherever he's run. He won the back-to-back events at the XR Series at Volunteer Speedway last weekend. He's been no less than a third-place finisher in just about every race he's running up until last night. But he started a little bit too far back to get onto the podium last night, but he still made a run up through the field. And this is the first time that Mike Marler has been at Lucas Oil Speedway since that horrible wreck a couple of years ago
when the track was
rough at the Show Me 100, and he hurt his back. And this is the first time he's been back, but he's committed to run the entire Lucas Oil late model series this year. So, you know, I thought maybe Mike would show up at Farmer City last night and run up there with World of Outlaws, but he decided to show back at Lucas Oil Speedway for the first time in a couple of years and kind of get things tuned up for the Show Me 100 here that just right around the corner.
Tony Jackson Jr. ended up running fifth.
Yeah. Started fifth, ended up fifth.
Right.
So, pretty good group of cars, and tonight's big payout.
Were you a little surprised by Chad Simpson not running as well as he did? He ended up running sixth.
Yeah, he didn't really. He just kind of finished where he started last night. I thought there were some pretty good lines around the track, didn't you?
I didn't think
it was a lockdown track by any means.
No, I didn't think so either.
So pretty good action. But the race that everybody's talking about was that World of Outlaw late model race at Farmer City last night. We touched on it in the first hour where Nick Hoffman beats Bobby Pierce to the line in a wild finish where the cars were off the racetrack. And it looked at first glance that Bobby Pierce had won. But you never really know where the transponder line is. But the transponder doesn't lie, and it said Nick Hoffman was ahead at the finish line, and Bobby Pierce drives to victory circle thinking he had won the race, but when he was told, well, yeah, it's what the transponder said. And you know, the first thing they check, and we saw this a couple of times last year, they don't automatically say that Nick Hoffman was the winner till they check the placement of the transponders, make sure they're in the right locations on these race cars before they officially declare the winner. So they made sure that the transponders were where they were supposed to be on both the Bobby Pierce and Nick Hoffman car before they declared
Hoffman
the winner. Hey, anytime
you hold off Bobby Pierce for the win, Nick Hoffman, he deserves that win.
Yeah. Yeah, he'd had the lead
right
through most of that race. So tonight, $20,000 to win for the Illini. It's a 100-lapper tonight at Farmer City for the World of Outlaw late models. So $20,000 to win races at both Lucas Oil Speedway and Farmer City if you're a big late model fan.
You know what? I might go down there tonight.
At Lucas Oil Speedway?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. Always welcome down there.
A couple of hours from here.
Might take the RV down there.
There you go. Stay all night.
Right.
Give old Danny Lorton a call and get it all set up. Love to have you.
You're straight face there, Kurt.
Yeah, you know what, I make fun of you. You always make decisions at the last minute on a lot of these things. That's what I'm making fun of you for. Hey, let's go check it out, you know? You don't plan very far in advance for a lot of these events, do you?
I never plan in advance for these events,
yeah.
To be honest with you.
You just kind of run with it.
Just run with it.
Yeah. What do you think?
I'm thinking about going out to maybe KCIR today.
Yep.
And then maybe going to MLRA race down there at Lucas Oil
Speedway. KCIR? Where's, if you're going, you might be by yourself if you're at
Well,
KCIR.
You know, that's right. The name they were going to use. Yeah. That was the name they were going to use when they put the plans out there at I-70.
Hey, Kirk.
Was KCIR.
Are you a little disappointed that they didn't use the word KCIR?
Well, Scott Higgs, when he bought the property, he's the Flying H guy. He's got the Flying H farm, so he owns the track. He gets to put his name on it. So Flying H drag strip, it is. But when Chris Payne put these plans out there that he was going to build the racetrack, KCIR was the name they had originally were going to put on that racetrack.
Mm-hmm.
But, hey, you know, the bottom line is the track is built, it's up and running, and Scott Higgs was the man, along with Blake Housley, to make that happen. So if Scott Higgs wants to put Flying H on his drag strip, I'm okay with it.
I'm with
it. So that's what it's called.
Yep, no doubt.
Hey,
but there was a good race between Buddy Kofoid and Carson Macedo last night at that World of Outlaw race, wasn't it?
Yeah, those two guys were duking it out. And I thought once Macedo had gotten past Buddy Kofoid that that was going to be that. But Buddy came around the outside and said, no, you don't. I'm taking it back. So I was impressed with the way Buddy maneuvered back around Carson Macedo there at the end to get second place.
Bill Balog might have been the biggest surprise of the night. Would you agree with that, Kurt?
Yeah, of course, it's becoming even more evident that it's not a surprise that Bill Balog is running up in the top 10 at a lot of these races. When you look at his background and see how many races he's won in his career, he's a good racer, and he's got good equipment, and I think he's going to win a race at some point. Bill Balog will win a World of Outlaw race at some point. I think it's going to be at one of these tracks that's up in Wisconsin, like, Beaver Dam or one of those places where he's got a lot of laps around that he's going to pull off a big win this year.
He's currently eighth in the points, 242 points behind the leader, David Gravel.
It's still so early on points. But
listen, to be honest with you, if you're 242 points behind, you're not going to catch up.
No, you're not going to. I just don't spend a whole lot of time talking about points right now, other than to say David Gravel has firmly and set himself as the clear favorite to win the World of Outlaw Championship this year with the way he's running and running so consistently this early in the season, and I don't see that changing. I'm not going to get into week-to-week points stuff until we get into the fall, and then we'll see where it all lays out. It's more fun just to go and see who wins these races on a nightly basis. That's kind of where I'm at with it. We've got the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame that we want to talk about.
Yeah, go ahead, Kurt.
The sweepstakes are off and running for both the Corvette and the Sprint Car giveaways. And we've got this beautiful torch red Corvette
Z06
convertible with the Z07 performance package that's already up in the window up at the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame where people can see it and they can win it. And all you have to do is get registered. Just go to winaz06corvette.com and you can get signed up for the ticket and get your tickets purchased for this beautiful Corvette. And also we've got the Sprint Car that we're giving away as well, and that's going to be drawn 2 days before Christmas this year on December 23rd. They only do this once every 2 years, the Sprint Car, and this 2024 they'll do it again. And go to ourwinasprintcar.com to get registered for the XXX chassis with an Al Parker Racing engine, a race-ready sprint car. You can win by getting signed up today, ourwinasprintcar.com. So the Corvette and the Sprint Car, it all goes to a great cause, the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame and Museum. They got the Eldora Speedway Salute coming up in 2024. That opens up on May 1st, and that's going to be great to see all the stuff they got in there. Saluting Eldora Speedway. A lot of history there, as we all know. And so that's all going to be on display at the National Sprint Car Hall of Fame and Museum. Induction ceremonies for the Hall of Fame is June 1st, which is also the night of non-wing USAC sprint cars at Knoxville. Can't wait for that. Opening night for Knoxville is next Saturday, a week from today, is opening night at Knoxville. So here we are, Scott. spring is here, seasons are opening up, and got a lot of racing going on now to talk about.
Did you see that new Corvette, Scott? Did you see that new video yesterday for the 2025 Corvette?
That's no, coming I haven't.
Out? We're going to play this video real quick here. This thing.
I don't think I've seen it either.
It's pretty cool. This is brand new from the Stingray Z06.
This is a Chevrolet commercial.
This brand new ZR1 technology. They're talking about this thing might be the unthinkable is what they're calling it. So, just
wow, that's a tease.
From what I've been told, it's going to have maybe 50 more horsepower than the car that they're giving away at the Sprint Car Hall of Fame. Can you imagine?
Mm-mm.
So this new, they're talking about it. So it's the, they said they're expecting to see a tuned-up version of the 5.5-liter V8 engine exceeding over 800 horsepower. So maybe next year's Corvette that they give away, we
would be 900 horsepower.
I just can't imagine what they're doing.
How can you top what you already got?
Unbelievable, guys. I mean, if you got the money, I guess, you know, you can spend it. Or you could just buy you a raffle ticket. And you know, there's also ways. We want you guys to buy a raffle ticket, but there's also a way for you to enter for free, too. A single one. You get a single ticket you can enter for free with your email address, too. So you can go to SprintCarHallOfFame.com and get that information. There's a link actually where you can click without purchasing. But if you want to have a multiple shot at winning this thing, you might want to purchase more than just one ticket, you know.
And listen, don't forget about the High Limit Series going to Lakeside Speedway on May 3rd and 4th as well.
Yeah, that's Friday and Saturday night, same weekend as NASCAR at Kansas Speedway. So looking forward to those two big nights. Racing for the High Limit Series are going to be at I-70 Motorsports Park.
On June 7th.
Yeah, that's the Rudine Classic, pays $20,000 to win.
June 7th weekend. And 8th.
Yep, 7th and 8th. So a lot more High Limit races in the Kansas City area. I think we only saw our one World of Outlaw event a week ago up at US 36 Raceway. Got a ton of High Limit stuff around with Lakeside and I-70 and Lake Ozark and Lucas Oil Speedway all hosting events this year, so we'll get a lot of High Limit racing in and around where we're at in the Kansas City area.
Lucas Oil Speedway is June 28th and 29th, Kurt.
That is it, and that's going to be a big big weekend as well on a Friday and Saturday night. Did you see Kyle Larson strapped in an Indy car this week and did a couple of laps around Indianapolis Motor Speedway?
Had the second fastest time.
Right.
He seemed to...
he's pretty comfortable in that Indy car.
He seemed to get comfortable in a hurry in that car. They had a press conference after the test, which was hampered a little bit by rain, and he gave a couple of surprising answers to the difference between what he's used to in the Cup car and the Indy car. He says it kind of feels like a Cup car a little bit, he said. The way it steers, the way it feels... I was surprised to hear him say that, but with this new next-gen car, the steering is a lot different on these new next-gen cars and the older Cup cars. He said the feel and the steering of the Indy car wasn't much different than the Cup car. I was surprised to hear him say that.
Well, that's a little shocking, to be honest with you.
Yeah. And so... He feels that he's still got a lot to learn, that don't take this time that he had with any seriousness, because there weren't all that many cars out there, and you can't judge times on a test like that and say that, oh, he's faster than everybody else. So, I agree with what he's saying there. He said, I got a lot to learn around traffic, who to race around. I don't know any of these guys. Another thing he said, you can see who you're racing with in a sprint car or a Cup car. With these Indy cars, you don't know who's in a lot of you. You don't know who's in these cars because you're going so fast. All the cars look the same. You don't know who you're racing around.
Right.
You can easily see who you're racing around in a sprint car and a cup car. So he's got a lot to learn there. He's concerned about, okay, who am I racing with here? And another thing he said, you got to see ahead a lot farther in these Indy cars.
You got to pay attention because you're going so fast.
Yeah. Not only do you have to look at the guy in front of you, but you got to look at everything in front of that guy, you know. And in other forms of racing, he doesn't have to do that. So I thought it was a very thoughtful press conference on his part, explaining some of the differences, some of the things he's got to learn. But I'm going to make a prediction that I think he's in a good car. Arrow McLaren, he's in a good piece.
Right.
And if he gets up to speed, I wouldn't be surprised he gets a top 10 finish.
Do you feel like he'll do better than Kurt Busch?
Yeah, I think so. Because, as we all know, Kyle Larson is as adaptable.
He ran eighth.
He did run eighth.
Right.
But as we all know, Kyle Larson is as adaptable to any kind of race car, switching from one kind of a car to the other, as anybody we've ever seen. You'd agree with that?
As long as he doesn't get taken out, right?
Yeah, as long as he gets taken out. But I wouldn't be shocked if Kyle Larson were able to even lead some laps and run up front of the Indy 500.
Come on now,
Kirk. How about that?
Come on, Kirk. You think he's going to lead some laps?
I wouldn't be shocked. If he gets enough laps around that racetrack in practice and doesn't get taken out, doesn't crash, mechanical issues. I think he's going to be in a fast race car, and he's talented enough driver that it wouldn't surprise me at all. I'm not going to predict he would win the race, but I wouldn't be surprised if he ran up front, maybe led some laps and was a factor in the race at some point.
I don't think he's going to lead a lap, if you want to know the truth. I don't think he's.
Are you ever surprised what Kyle Larson does? You're not.
No, I'm never surprised what he does. But I just don't think he'll lead a lap, to be honest with you. There's too many talented drivers over there in that IndyCar series for him to lead a lap, to be honest with you. I might be wrong, but I just don't think he'll lead a lap.
It's going to be fun to watch, though, isn't it?
Yep, it is. All right, thanks, everybody.
Will he be at a sprint car tonight at Texas Motor Speedway Dirt Track?
I don't know if he will or not.
Is he allowed the night before a cup race to go race his front?
I think he does.
He'll be in a sprint car tonight at Texas Motor Speedway Dirt Track.
Paul Silva car, you think?
Sure.
Yep.
Yeah, he's raced the night before a cup race before. Knoxville Nationals.
Right.
So he'll be behind the wheel of the 57 tonight at Texas Motor Speedway Dirt Track.
Kirk, are you guaranteeing that?
I can't guarantee anything.
Right.
But I expect
you're speaking like you're guaranteeing that that's going to happen.
But he'll be in the car at Lakeside Speedway the weekend of the Cup race out at Kansas Speedway. He'll be at Lakeside racing his car. So. No, I fully expect to see Kyle Larson behind the wheel of 57 tonight.
All right, thanks everybody for tuning in to Track Talk today. Don't forget, Mostly Motorsports airs on Monday at 12 noon to 2 o'clock. That's our national show that we do each and every week, and we can't wait to have people check in from all around the country.
Episode 308 coming up.
308, Monday. Right?
I believe so. Might be 309, but I think it's
309.
If I bet money on it, I'd say 308.
All right. What do you think about that, Kirk? 308 shows.
How about that? Mm-hmm. We didn't do anything special when it was 300, did we?
No, we didn't.
We
just kind of let it fly.
We were going to give away some shirts and stickers, and then you know what happened? We got another caller. We had another guest on that day, and we forgot that it was our 300th episode, so we just kind of.
Just
went on by as another day.
Went on by it.
So who wins the Masters tomorrow there,
Todd? Boy, did you see the wind? Oh, my gosh. These poor guys put their ball down on the thing, Scott, tried to place their ball on the green, and they got ready to putt it. The ball rolled off the green because the wind was blowing so hard.
You know, that's crazy. The wind in Augusta, Georgia was blowing just as much as it was here in Kansas
City. Absolutely. Just insane.
What do you make of that?
I've been trying to water my grass seed, and I have to put my my sprinkler to where it just barely reaches it. You know, I can't do the big flow.
Right.
I have to do it because once it gets in the air, it just blows it all over. The wind is just, I mean, I know March, you know, they always say March is what? March like a lion, in like a lion, out like a lamb. Is that what they used to say? But
that's
man,
it.
This wind the last few days has been something else. Did you see that truck that got blown over in Africa, in South Africa? They're having winds over there so bad.
So this is all over the world.
The whole world. You know, Denver had recorded 95 mile an hour winds the other day. 95.
The atmosphere in the world is changing.
You got to quit cutting down all the trees.
Quit cutting down all the trees.
That's why the wind's so bad.
Good point, Todd.
Remember when they cut down the trees on Lakeside and all we had dirt just flying? It was like,
I know this. It's causing a lot of problems with the track prep guys to prep these racetracks.
They're
with
all,
that wind blowing.
Everyone that I've seen said the same thing. How much water and how much sun compared to the wind, like the wind variable in this thing is outrageous. Like you can't even determine how much water because the sun's setting on it. And now today, guys, we're talking, we might break a record here in Kansas City tomorrow. High 80s. There may be somebody hitting a 90.
They're talking about it hitting 90 degrees.
Wow.
The current record is 92 degrees.
That's right.
And get the summer gear out, shorts weather.
And then they're calling for another frost 2 weeks after that. So
wow.
It is what it is, guys. It's
but
racing.
People, be easy on the track prep,
that's right,
guys.
That's exactly right.
This is a nightmare prepping dirt tracks with these heavy winds out there.
With the winds like this and cold temperatures, you're not getting this, you know, like you said, I've was really good to hear all the good reports from Lakeside at our local track here that had really good track last night, so that's good. They were able to get theirs prepped in. And be safe out there, guys. Have fun if you're out there racing and shaking down your car out there at the new drag strip. Have fun out there. That sounds like going to be a blast out there.
And again, I want to send out my thoughts and prayers to Steve Cabbage's family. Lost Steve this past weekend. Worked with him up at Adams County Speedway up there. Is on the announce crew up there. Suddenly passed away this past weekend. And our thoughts and prayers go out to Rick, his brother, and his entire family up there thinking about you.
And we're also thinking about our old buddy Lloyd.
That's right.
Yep.
And, man, you know, it was a great service last Sunday. We all gathered over at the Whitechapel, and to remember our good friend Lloyd. It was a tough day. I got to admit, Scott, I woke up and drove up there. That was tough.
Yeah,
that was tough. No. But you know, we all walked out of there feeling, you know, a lot better about remembering Lloyd, and you know, he'll never be forgotten. And I'm thinking tonight, this weekend, I didn't tune in earlier in the night, but I expect him to honor Lloyd down at Lucas Oil Speedway this weekend.
You know, Kirk, when I went down and saw him, he passed away that night.
Yeah, it's just, Rochelle, we're thinking about you.
I knew it wasn't going to be good,
to
be honest with you.
So Rochelle, his lovely wife, his family, it was great to talk with his son, daughter, Rochelle, his wife, at the service last weekend. And, you know, they're going through a tough time right now. We're thinking about you and the Cabbage family as well. It's been a tough week for me dealing with these losses. And, you know, just it all, you know, boils back to, you know, tell your loved ones you love them every day. Don't take anything for granted.
Well, you know what's really good is that I take Will from Grandma's out to my daughter's, and I get to see my daughter every day.
Yeah. And you tell her you love her every day.
I tell her I love her every day.
Yeah.
Yep. No doubt about it.
So just life is precious out there. Be careful out there driving to the racetrack, and we'll be here on Monday to talk about everything that's going on tonight and tomorrow.
All right, thanks everybody for tuning in here to Track Talk. Don't forget, Monday, mostly motorsports. It starts at 12 noon Central Time. It goes to 2 o'clock. And we can't thank Todd enough for doing everything that he does for us here at RBN, the Racing Boys Broadcast Network. For my partner, Kirk Elliott, I'm Scott Traylor saying thanks for joining us. It's all been brought to you by Rod End Supply, featuring the Power Eye Midwest Lightning Sprints. And we can't thank our guest enough today as well. All right, Todd, take it away.
Go harder, faster, stronger with Rod End Supply. Whether you are running industrial, farming equipment, or a race car, Rod End Supply has the assortment of rod ends, radius rods, and specialty products that will help you lead the field in performance. Our superior design means our rod ends last longer and perform better, giving you the edge on the track and saving you money. Contact Rod End Supply or order online today at rodendsupply.com. We don't just sell them, we race them. Rodendsupply.com, serving the racing community for over 30 years.